In the twilight of the 17th century, amidst the stately halls of Blicklin in Norfolk, Our Lady was born into the noble lineage of the Hobarts. Despite her family's prestige, her childhood was steeped in sorrow and struggle. Tragedy struck early, snatching away her father in a duel's cruel aftermath, and her mother to the relentless grip of illness. The once grand Hobart household found itself trapped in the clutches of debt, each passing day tightening its grip. In 1706, at the tender age of 17, he was perhaps driven by a quest for stability, or maybe swayed by youthful affection, entered into matrimony with Charles Howard, the youngest progeny of the 5th Earl of Suffolk. The birth of their son Henry the following year seemed a glimmer of hope, but it was a fleeting joy in the grand tapestry of her life. So join me now as we look back on the tumultuous life of Henrietta Howard. Their union unravelled into a mosaic of despair. The 4th Earl of Chesterfield, a friend of Henrietta, later painted their marriage in stark hues, a journey from love to matrimony and, inevitably, to mutual loathing. Charles, a man of fierce nature, prone to bouts of drunkenness, stubbornness, and brutal extravagance, frittered away their means. Once dwelling in comfort, the Howards found themselves transient, shadowed constantly by the spectre of debt, moving from one humble abode to another, less inviting. In this labyrinth of desperation, Henrietta found herself often hungry, living in perpetual fear of her volatile husband. She would later recount that these years were marred by circumstances of horror. But within Henrietta burned an indomitable spirit, a refusal to succumb to the bleakness of her reality. In a bold stroke of determination, she amassed the necessary funds, embarking with Charles to Hanover in Germany. Her eyes were set on the horizon, on a future where the Hanoverian rulers would ascend the British throne after Queen Anne. Here, Henrietta hoped to weave a new destiny, find favour in the eyes of those who would soon govern her homeland, and rise from the ashes of her past tribulations into a future of her own making. As the dawn of the Georgian era rose over Great Britain, Henrietta Howard's astute manoeuvring in the political chessboard of Hanover bore fruit. In August 1714, with the accession of George I, her fortunes ascended dramatically. She was appointed a woman to the bedchamber to Caroline, Princess of Wales, a role of immense privilege and proximity to power. Her husband, Charles Howard, paralleled her rise, securing a position as a groom of the bedchamber to the king. But Henrietta's ascent did not halt there. In a striking turn of events, she became the mistress to the Prince of Wales, Caroline's husband, who would later reign as George II. In the gilded corridors of European royalty, the role of a mistress was not a hidden scandal, but a position woven into the fabric of royal prestige. It was a symbol of influence and a testament to the prince's grandeur, as noted by contemporary observers like John Hervey and Horace Walpole. Walpole's portrayal of the Prince of Wales's intentions painted a picture of a ruler eager to assert his independence and masculine gallantry, distancing himself from the notion of being under his wife's sway. Navigating these dual roles demanded a dance of delicacy and discretion from Henrietta, balancing the intimate part of a mistress with a dutiful service to the princess required a mastery of courtly politics and personal diplomacy. Yet these roles were not mere burdens, they were the keys to a realm of possibilities, offering Henrietta a pathway to a life she could scarcely have imagined, a life of influence, stability, and perhaps most importantly, a measure of independence within the gilded cage of royal favour. At St. James's Palace, Henrietta and Charles Howard found not just shelter, but also a source of income, a welcome respite in their tumultuous lives. However, 1717 brought a royal rift that reshaped Henrietta's existence. With King George I and the Prince of Wales at loggerheads, the prince established a separate court at Leicester House. Seizing this opportunity, Henrietta moved there, leaving Charles at the king's court. This separation from Charles was a relief, albeit tinged with the sorrow of being apart from her son. Henrietta's presence grew in stature in the vibrant ambience of Leicester House. Her charm and wit earned her admiration from the era's cultural and political luminaries. She forged alliances with figures like Alexander Pope, Jonathan Swift, and John Gay, created a nexus of influence and intellect around her. Although her position as the king's mistress granted her power, her cunning and ability to seize opportunities amplified her impact, as noted by Lord Hervey. Henrietta's discretion and ability to navigate the intricate webs of court intrigue were legendary. Her tact earned her the moniker the Swiss, a nod to her neutrality and diplomatic skills. Her living quarters, known as the Swiss Cantons, became a sanctuary where political and cultural plans were subtly woven away from the prying eyes of the court, and this period marked a significant evolution in Henrietta's journey, from a figure seeking stability to one shaping the very dynamics of court politics and cultural discourse. In the prime of her life, as Henrietta adeptly manoeuvred the intricate maze of court politics, she was beset by an unforeseen challenge: hearing loss. This affliction, which began in her late 20s or early 30s, added a poignant layer to her courtly image. In his poem A Certain Lady at Court, Alexander Pope captured this with admiration and ambiguity, highlighting her disregard for flattery in a world where compliments were currency. Undeterred, Henrietta sought relief, turning to Dr. Cheselden, the surgeon to Queen Caroline, around 1728. Driven by the hope of a remedy, Henrietta underwent a harrowing surgical procedure on her jaw, which might have been an early and ambitious effort to address her eardrum affliction. The process brought not relief, but almost insupportable pain and weeks of misery. In her later years, Henrietta adapted to her condition using a tortoiseshell hearing trumpet. Horace Walpole observed her preference for storytelling over listening, a shift in her social interactions shaped by her hearing loss. But Henrietta's struggle and adaptation to this personal adversity added yet another dimension to her complex and resilient character. In a remarkable turn of events in 1723, the Prince of Wales gave Henrietta a gift of immense value and significance. This treasure trove included opulent items like a gilt plate, a diamond ring, a ruby cross and gold watches, and an array of chinaware, plate, linen and furnishings from her court lodgings, but also financial assets of great worth. Among these were investments in the South Sea Company and the Bank of England, amounting to a staggering £11,500, nearly 40 times her annual salary. The significance of this gift extended beyond its material value. It represented a bold move in a society where a woman's possessions typically became her husband's property upon marriage. The prince explicitly intended this wealth to provide Henrietta with a means of living free from her husband's control. This gesture of independence allowed her to maintain the proceeds as her own, whether by selling any part of the gift or from investments made. This monumental gift catalyzed a transformative chapter in Henrietta's life. It granted her the financial autonomy she had long been denied, enabling her to establish residence. The following year, construction began on Marble Hill, symbolizing her newfound independence, resilience, and the unexpected turn her life had taken. Marble Hill, envisioned as a serene haven, promised Henrietta Howard an escape from the rigors of court life and her oppressive marriage. Yet it took her 2 decades after its inception to fully embrace this retreat. Throughout this period, Charles persistently troubled her for money, a reminder of the ties that she yearned to sever. In 1728, she reached a pivotal moment when King George II, having ascended the throne, augmented Henrietta's allowance. This increase was strategic, enabling her to negotiate a deed of separation with Charles, a bold and unconventional move for that era designed to mitigate public scandal. In 1731 marked another milestone. Henrietta became the Countess of Suffolk, elevating her court status and easing her responsibilities. This change afforded her more leisure to relish the tranquility of Marble Hill. She expressed to her friend John Gay a newfound optimism for a more joyful latter part of her life. With Charles's death in 1732, Henrietta finally broke free from the court's golden chains in 1734. Turning a page to a chapter filled with independence and fulfilling long-held aspirations. Leaving the court intrigues behind, Henrietta Howard embarked on a new chapter of personal fulfilment. In 1735, she married George Bartley, a relationship brimming with affection and mutual respect, contrasting starkly with her tumultuous first marriage. In her letters, she affectionately referred to Bartley as her life, soul, and joy, revealing the depth of their bond. At Marble Hill, they cultivated a serene and orderly life, hosting friends, travelling, and engaging in intellectual and cultural pursuits. Contrary to expectations, Henrietta's social influence flourished, drawing notable figures like Horace Walpole into her circle. The vibrancy of her gatherings at Marble Hill became so renowned that Alexander Pope likened it to a rival court. This period marked a triumphant assertion of Henrietta's enduring influence and personal happiness. In the later years at Marble Hill, Henrietta Howard faced joy and sorrow. Her son's death in 1745 was a profound loss, yet she found solace in caring for her niece and nephew, John and Dorothy Hobart. Her correspondence with George reflects a nurturing yet firm approach towards their young charges. Tragically, her blissful marriage with George came to an end with his death in 1746. Later, she welcomed her great-niece, Henrietta Hotham, into Marble Hill and formed a close bond. This companionship was a source of comfort in her final years. Despite a brief recovery from illness, Henrietta passed away in the tranquility of Marble Hill's bedchamber on the 26th of July, 1767, closing the chapter on a life marked by resilience, transformation, and the pursuit of independence.